the emotion, and it is substitution for each other, so therefore they are equivalent. So this is why stimulus equivalence and behavior analysis accounts for symbolic behavior. So although we have a lot of applications for stimulus equivalence, there's not that many applications to do with social or emotional regulation. So thus far, there have only been 3 studies which have specifically looked at teaching social discrimination or emotional discrimination. So it's quite limited research base that we are building on here. You can see all 3 of these studies were involving individuals with intellectual disabilities, from mild to severe intellectual disability. And it is a limited pool of participants. So in total, that's only 6 participants that have been conducting this research. So these, typically the studies will teach happy, sad, and angry. Those are sort of your generic go-to emotions. A few have looked at more different emotions, such as anger, afraid, and surprise. So all of the 3 of these studies found positive results. So they increased facial recognition of emotional equivalence and the stimulus equivalence. 2 out of 3 of the studies also tested for generalization to new stimuli, and they again found positive effects there. So the study that was conducted was with 9 individuals in total. We had 2 girls and 7 boys, and their age range was from 9 to 12 years. So these kids were either in primary school or intermediate level. All of the children in the study had been diagnosed by the same team in Rotorua. They were diagnosed as either level 1 or 2 on the spectrum based on the current DSM. And none of them had any intellectual disability diagnosis. So all of the children were performing at or above the level that was expected for their age at school, so they had no academic deficits. But as you can see from the table here, they did have deficits in social areas such as communication, recognizing different emotions, and establishing and maintaining relationship. So parents were also asked to report on how often the children could recognize the different emotions that were going to be established during the study. And for almost all the parents, they responded that they either didn't know or that their child really, very rarely engaged, was able to recognize a particular emotion. So this is the types of stimuli that were trained in the study. So first we had the isolated facial expression. So we used children that were the same age as our participants, so between 6 to 11 years, and the facial expressions were described as spontaneous and medium intensity. Because when you think about it in normal social situations, you don't have people doing a big massive grin, they do a more subtle expression. So this is more like to have generalized disability to the real world. So these were all in black and white, and it's just because of the set that they were taking from. Then there was the text with the written name of that emotion on it. And then social emotional context situations. So it would have a scene and the face would be blurred so that they couldn't use the face as a cue to what the emotion was in that scene. So here we have an example of a child hugging a kitten, and that would be representative of happy. So for each, for A and C, there were 3 exemplars for each emotion. So we can't sort of, it means that we're not risking that. Maybe the kid doesn't think that cats are something that make you happy, because we've got 2 other emotions that they're able to be trained for. 2 other exemplars in that situation. We also had the auditory stimulus, where the child was asked, what does she, he feel when presented with one of the facial expressions? And then there were generalization probes, which used a novel range of facial expressions and social settings, as well as videos, so short clips showing people engaging in a social situation. So this is just quickly the procedure that was followed. So it began with the preliminary probes, which was testing for children naming the emotions that were shown on the picture cards. Then pre-testing, we tested for all of the relations that could exist between the different stimuli. Then they were trained to match the face to the written emotion, and then tested for symmetry. And then they received, they had to taste the text to the social setting and then tested for symmetry. And then tested for equivalence and transitivity once those symmetry was established. And then finally generalization and a retesting with the what are they feeling question. So we've got a short video here showing what this will look like. So this is the equivalence part of the scale. And behind the video there, that's an example of the token board that was being used for each individual. So Julian, for example, he was working for a cup of tea and some cheese slices. So when they got gone wrong, we would have a retrial and then an elimination until they got the right response. So aside from the initial probe for labelling, this was all done automatically, so that was the only part that was done manually, and it was all done through the MatchRoom program. So the children were taught to associate the facial expression and the written word, and then we tested for the symmetrical relationship, and we retrained them until they achieved symmetry. Then they were trained in the label to the social scenario, and then the testing for the other associations with generalization. So rather than showing you individual data, we've just got the group data here. And that's because that there are 6 graphs for each of the 9 children, so that might be a bit too much data for ABI. So we're just looking here at the data for the children who did not have equivalence when they were tested in the preliminary probes. So that's why you see that there's different numbers of groups for each of these graphs. Okay, so that was due to the variability of response. So any of the participants that were scoring over 66% for transitivity and equivalence aren't included in that graph. So we did the Wilcoxon sign rank test to test for statistical significance. And you can see that we found significance for happy and sad for stimulus equivalence, and angry for AV and XC. Although we didn't get statistical significance for the other emotions, we did obviously have practical gains for individual children where at the start of the study they weren't able to demonstrate any equivalence or symmetry, but they were towards the end of the study. We also see here we have the pre and protests for the stimulus A probes. And so all children are included in this graph here. And you can see an improvement in just labelling from the beginning of the study to the end of the study. And that was found to be statistically significant. It seems that the stimulus equivalence program was really effective in teaching children to identify and to create these stimulus relationships between the facial emotions and the social situations. And considering that many of these children were what would be classified as Asperger's syndrome, this is a really important finding. So parents were asked at the end of the study to answer some questions about how valuable they found the study on a scale from 0 to 4. So whether or not it was important for their children to learn this skill, which you can see is 3.75. Whether or not they thought there were any unwanted problems, so 0 being no, there were no unwanted problems. So you can see that the parents tended to find this program quite valuable for them. So I've finished, and it's going to talk to you guys.
So this study comes to some interesting points for further study. I would start by saying that there is a necessity to try out more applications of EBI with emotion recognition. The largest amount of research on stimulus equivalence has mainly been done in laboratory settings with pigeons and simple stimuli. However, we know that in the real world with real people, stimuli are more complex, and I would agree that there is a need to decode the complexity of the stimuli and to analyze how it's used in humans. So as a further step, we would be looking into breaking down the heterogeneity of autism, taking some clear measures on language and cognition, and adding an ADHD group and a control group, and taking some data on multiple baseline data across groups of participants and record their learning patterns. Also, we are thinking of using iTrack technology that can be beneficial in measuring responding that is attentive or inattentive, because we know that these kids could have give the false impression that they're not learning, although they're just not attending. So yes, there's still a lot that needs to be done, and hopefully we will carry on doing so. Thank you.
So thank you guys for listening. Just a special thanks to Mad Studios, who are the ones who developed the app that was used to teach these children. And you guys can find that on the Google Play Store, or check them out on Facebook if you're interested. Thank you.